stepping a little bit back into 2 Timothy today, and the portion that we have to consider is in 2 Timothy chapter 2, and we're going to read from verses 8 to 13. Paul writes here, "Remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David, as preached in my gospel, for which I am suffering, bound with chains as a criminal. But the word of God is not bound. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. The saying is trustworthy, for if we died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful." When I started preparing this word and I read through this portion, there was a phrase that immediately jumped off the paper and grabbed hold of my heart. And that phrase is the one that says, "I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they may obtain salvation." Or as some translations say, "I endure everything for the sake of those who must be saved." And that is why the title of this message is, "Will You Endure?" I ask that question of each one of us, and I pray that you will answer that honestly and truly. Will you endure? Will you endure if there should be persecution? If there should be difficult circumstances? Now, Paul started off here by first of all saying then, remember Jesus Christ. And we're going to start with Jesus Christ. Did Jesus endure? You know, if we think that his birth was a lowly one. Historians tell us it was possibly a cave in which he was born, a place where animals usually sheltered. And he, as a baby, King Herod tried to kill him. He was so threatened by the thought that the wise men said to him, a baby king has been born, that he killed all the babies in that whole area to try and make sure that he got hold of Jesus. And as Jesus grew up and he worked, if you think his hometown Nazareth, wouldn't a town be excited to welcome back a son that had seen growing up there and being used by God now? But no, they tried to throw him off a high cliff, hoping that he would be shattered and die there. When he healed people, the leaders of the synagogue would rebuke him all the time. And when he raised Lazarus from the dead, well, that was just too much. They couldn't take that anymore. They decided this man must be killed. And then they paid Judas Iscariot to deliver him. Why was Jesus willing to go through all of that? And if you think that just before he was arrested, he was there in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he knew exactly what was waiting for him. He knew what the agony, what the pain, the kind of death he was going to die. And he knew it was the time now. And he could have called upon millions of angels to come and protect him, to fight for him, or to whisk him away. But no, he didn't. He stayed there because of his incredible love for us. He wanted to fulfill his Father's desire. And do you realize that God the Father loves each one of us so much that he is actually postponing, he has been doing that, postponing the return of Jesus so that more can be saved, to give more opportunity for salvation. Jesus wanted us to be reconciled with his Father. He endured to the very, very end so that we here this morning could be saved. He also trained disciples to take over the work when he had finished because he wanted the gospel message to continue. Would anyone be able to stop this word? Would anyone be able to ever stop the gospel message from continuing? I believe not. God sent the Holy Spirit. He came down with might on the day of Pentecost, and the believers were filled with power and with boldness that they could go from there and carry on spreading the gospel story. Let's look at Paul. He's the man who wrote this letter. Paul was in prison when he was writing this. This was his second imprisonment in Rome. He knew this time he was not going to be let free again as happened with the first imprisonment in Rome. No, he was now in a dungeon. He was waiting for his death. A little bit further on, I think in chapter 3, we read that he knew the end had come for himself. He had a goal in his life. His goal, his life goal, his purpose for living was that many be saved. And he was not satisfied to just bring them to conversion. He wanted to see transformed lives. He wanted to see transformed lives that people would obey God for the rest of their lives and obey all the time. Even today, his writings are of such great blessing to us. Let's face it, a big part of our New Testament was written by Paul. His life was definitely not in vain. At the end, he could say, I have fought the good fight. I've completed the race. I've kept the faith. And now there is waiting for me the crown of righteousness. After his conversion on the road to Damascus, he became a powerful evangelist. He preached all over the then known world. He moved further and further west to places where the gospel had not gone before. Well, the Romans were cross with him because they said, you must worship Caesar and only Caesar. The Greeks apparently believed that if divinity came into contact with humanity, it is spoilt. It is defiled. So how could they believe in Jesus? And then there were, of course, those, you remember the people in Ephesus who were so upset because their livelihood was in danger. Yeah, they were making these little silver shrines of the goddess Diana. And if people believed in Jesus, they would not continue to buy these little idols. But everywhere Paul went and ministered, there were those who believed. There were those who accepted the gospel of Jesus Christ and believed. His life was not in vain. He suffered terribly. He was beaten on how many occasions? If you think early on in his ministry, he had to be let over a wall in a basket, the wall of a city, in a basket to get away from the people who wanted to kill him. In Lystra, he was stoned and left for dead. In Philippi, he was beaten with rods and thrown into prison. He was shipwrecked on a few occasions, bitten by an extremely poisonous snake, so many times arrested on false charges. Did that put him off? No. Paul endured. Why did he endure? Because he wanted to seek and save the lost. He wanted to see transformed lives for Jesus. Well, eventually he was killed. We believe historians say he was beheaded. all his suffering then led to eternal glory. Can you imagine what Paul is experiencing in heaven today? If we could talk to him today, I'm absolutely convinced he would say to us, "Don't feel sorry for me, for what I went through. It was all worth it." And he will say, "It's glorious now. It's joy upon joy upon joy. Praise the Lord." Wonderful. He also trained people to take over for him because he didn't want the gospel to be stopped. We think of people like Timothy and Titus, and there were a number of others who took over from him. He was a man, I believe that we could say, his preaching was by word and by example. He lived what he preached. And that is so very, very important. I want every one of us to really take that into our hearts. It's no good just going out there and speaking the word unless you are living the word of God. He wrote this letter to Timothy. When Paul was on his second missionary visit, he came to the town where Timothy lived, and he was most impressed with this young man. The church there spoke very highly of him. So he invited Timothy as a young chap to come with him and to travel with him. And as far as I can make out, he was with Paul right up until the end. He was a faithful servant. And Paul made it very clear to Timothy that you must not expect anything less than what has happened to me. Expect the same thing. Life will not be easy for you. And we know he was also imprisoned. And then it's just remember, in Matthew 10, verse 16, Jesus himself said, "Behold, I send you out as sheep in the midst of wolves." And we know that wolves will devour whenever they get the opportunity. We here in South Africa, aren't we absolutely blessed? We have not experienced any persecution. The little bit of hardship you may have found here or there is nothing. Right now, this very minute, in other countries, there are countries in the world where I believe people right now are being arrested, are being imprisoned, are their blood being shed because they're worshiping Jesus or they're preaching the word of God. May God have mercy on us if it should ever come our way. You know, an American missionary tells the story of how he went to the underground church in China. And he said people traveled for days on end to get there. And they sat on a concrete floor day after day, drinking in the word that this missionary was sharing with them. And because it was against the law, this missionary said to them, "What will happen if we found out?" And they said, "Well, you will probably be deported and we will be imprisoned." And he was astounded that they could speak so calmly about imprisonment. And then he realized that the vast majority of them had been imprisoned, some for years before this already, for worshiping the Lord. And some of them knew the word so well. He said, "How come? How have you managed this?" And they said, "When we're in prison, people will come and smuggle in a little piece of a page of the word of God. And they say, when we get that piece of word, we learn it off by heart as fast as we can. Because we know if it's found, it will be taken away from us." And then they say, "Somebody else will bring me another piece of Bible. And I'll learn that off by heart." And then the day before he left, they said to him, "Brother, will you pray for us that we can be like our American brothers and sisters?" And to their astonishment, he said to him, "Oh, no." He said, "I will rather go and pray for the American Christians to become like you." He said, because in America, and I believe that applies to a large extent in South Africa too, he said, if the church is far away, then they don't go. It's too far. He said, "You have walked for days to get here." He said, "In America, if the seats aren't comfortable, people complain. You've been sitting here on a concrete floor day after day. If the service carries on more than an hour in America, people complain it's too long. You've sat here day after day after day." And friends, in spite of all the persecution in China, I've been told, it may be more now, but at this stage, there were over 100 million believers in China. The few places where I've been privileged to go and minister in Africa and in India, I've found exactly the same thing. You can minister and minister and teach the word and speak more of the word, and they always want more and more and more. I can recall occasion where I would say, "Well, I think it's time for a tea break." "No, Mama, no, just give us more." There's one area in a reasonably northern part of Kenya that I, a couple of times, had a conference, and there would be a few, I think it was about five or six people, leaders of small churches, who would travel, walking most of the way for 3 or 4 days to get there. And those same people would come every time, every single time their conference is being held there. And I remember amongst them, there was one elderly lady, as thin as a bean pole. And she would be there every time. They would walk most of the way because it was a dangerous mountainous area that she would cross over from the northern parts of Uganda. And they didn't have money. When they came to a place where the transport was available, they simply didn't have the money to pay for it. But they came, and they would just want, you can understand then, people who are willing to do that will want as much as possible to fill their hearts and their minds with the maximum of what they could take. My friends, if you think in terms of those Chinese, do you appreciate your Bible? You know, the Bible, your Bible, should be your most precious possession. Have you ever considered that? Many of you have possibly got a couple of Bibles at home. There are believers in various parts of the world that do not own a single one. Cherish it, study it. Meditate on the word, and if you are still able to, try and learn some off by heart. You know, I found that I can't remember all the scriptures that I used to know off by heart, because I'm afraid as you get older, your mind just doesn't work the same way it did when you were young. The gospel cannot be stopped. The word must continue. Will you be one who will carry it further? What is the main purpose of your life? Think about that. Have you considered the very, very main purpose of your life? I know many of you are employed, and God wants you to give your best in the place where you work. But what stops you from speaking about Jesus at a tea break or a lunch break or after work as you travel or wherever? Or is your main purpose to make as much money as possible? What is the main purpose of your life? Consider that very carefully. And you know, the Lord certainly made it clear that we have to be willing to suffer for the gospel's sake. In 2 Timothy 3 verse 12, we read, "Remember that everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted." And then I want to read Matthew 16 verses 24 to 27. I know these are words that you all know, but let's just clearly think about it again. Then Jesus told his disciples, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he has done." You know, these are words that we sometimes just read so easily without really thinking about what they mean and what it's saying to us. I do believe that it's worth to spend time thinking about eternity. Think of the glory and the joy waiting for you there. And here, in the here and now, if you know you're walking with the Lord, if you know you are doing what is pleasing to Him, you have such joy and such peace inside of your heart. And that's a joy and a peace that the world can't take away from you. No matter what happens around you, you will keep that. So when I talk about suffering for Jesus, let that not put you off. Because what you get is so much greater and so much more wonderful. And if the road gets tough, just turn to Jesus. And he will strengthen you and he will encourage you. Think about these promises. Colossians 3 verse 4. "When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory." And Revelation 3 verse 21. "The one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne." Do you realize that's possible for you? To sit with Jesus on his throne. These, just before I leave this part, because there's something else I want to tell you. It's something that's serious that we must just look at in this scripture portion. There are beautiful things written there, but there's this one very serious warning. If we deny him, he will also deny us. Friends, that's serious. And in Hebrews 10 verse 38, we read, "If we shrink back, God's soul has no pleasure in us." Don't mess with God. It's not a game. But spend your life on something that has got, that matters for eternity. So, my friends, I want to say to you today, let's just get up and run the race. Let us get rid of everything that hinders us, and let us run the race set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. Are you willing to do that? At times, the path the Lord leads you on may get very steep and difficult. It may take your energy. You may be lonely at times, or rather feel lonely. But you never know. There may just be those who follow your example, do the same thing because they see what you are doing. And you may never know about it, but it's possible that that is taking place. Imagine it can feel as though you are climbing Mount Everest. But I want to assure you that God has got a lifeline attached to you. And if you feel that you just cannot anymore, and you feel as maybe my foot is going to slip and I'm going to fall now, He's got you. He won't let go. He's promised, I will be with you till the end of the age. David Livingstone was a Scottish physician. He came to Africa in the 1800s. And I believe he married his wife in South Africa. And the two of them traveled up, they crossed Africa, the continent, from the west coast to the east coast. They discovered many beautiful places. But as they went, they carried the gospel with them. And his wife died at the age of 41. She died of malaria. And he buried her, I think it was on the banks of the Zambezi River. He helped to dig that grave, to prepare a body, made a coffin. And he was there at a funeral, helping to let this coffin go down. And they scraped some earth over it to cover it. And then he stood up, and he took his Bible in his hands, and he opened it at Matthew 28. And he read verses 19 and 20. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. And he said, Jesus is too much of a gentleman not to keep his word. He said, he's been with me all the way. If you're tempted to just give up and live an easy life, just relax at home and, you know, especially once you're retired, it would be so nice and easy just to sit back and I've done my bit, I'm just going to relax now. But then I want to remind you of Romans 8, verses 16 and 17. Just think of this. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. And then verse 19 says, for I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. Don't ever think that it's a waste of time to share the gospel. You know, even if it looks as though nobody is listening, nobody is responding to what you say, you are sowing seeds. And maybe one day those people will remember those words that you have spoken. And there will be others who will come and water those seeds, and God gives the growth. And then, you know, there will be other days again when you share the word and everybody just seems to enjoy it. And it's wonderful and I love it. So keep on. Keep on keeping on and endure. And in conclusion, I want to say, remember Jesus. We started with that, and I want to end with that. Remember Jesus. Remember what he suffered for you. Remember how much he suffered so that we could have the gospel. Remember the people that have gone before. there are many, many people before us who sacrificed, many who laid down their lives, shed their blood, that you and I today can have the gospel, that we can believe, that we can know we're children of God. Now it's up to you. It's in your hands now. Are you going to join those who have said, we will endure? We will carry the cross. My friend, think of generations to come. Think of the future. Don't be the one who drops the ball and who doesn't carry it forward. Think of your children, your grandchildren. Think of all who will come after you. Will you endure? And apart from that, do you want a life filled with joy? Then carry the gospel. Share the gospel. It gives you joy like nothing on this world can. What a wonderful Lord we serve. What a great and a mighty God. Let's just praise the Lord. Endure, because He endured. And if there's anybody here who doesn't know Jesus yet, I want to say to you, don't let today go by without doing something about it. He's the best friend. Jesus is the best friend you can ever, ever have. And don't be put off by all this talk of suffering. I know I've spoken a lot about suffering. But don't be put off by that, because what He gives you is just so much greater, so much more than this world can ever give you. There is nothing, nothing in this world that you can ever achieve or ever get hold of that comes near what the Lord gives you in your life. So don't.